Salve, salve, galera. Aeroporto de Natal desembarcando agora para mais um Programa Cientista.
Diário de bordo da SBPQ 2016. Eu peguei um voo muito apertado do Rio para Natal. Então eu cheguei, o voo pousou às 5h10 da tarde lá no aeroporto, como mostrei para vocês. E o congresso começava às 5h30. Mas até pegar a mala e conseguir fazer o translado do aeroporto até o hotel, que é longe, são uns 40 km, levou mais de 1 hora para fazer isso. Acabei chegando tarde demais aqui no hotel, então a secretaria estava fechada, então não consegui chegar no congresso no primeiro dia. Eu vou ficar devendo a abertura para vocês, mas amanhã eu vou estar lá, então vou até dormir cedo agora para conseguir chegar lá bem cedo e mostrar o que está acontecendo no congresso para vocês. Foi mal.
Functional ASP1 protocol. We have done this experience and we will project already. So we show here that the wild-type plants suffer much more from oxidative stress than the progenitor plants. We have already evidence from isolated mitochondria that UCP can really attenuate loss production. So we show that using these transgenic plants.
However, and the fusion of the inner mitochondrial membrane. This is related to mitochondrial dynamics. Cytochrome C can fuse the inner mitochondrial membrane. What the role of cytochrome C in this process? This is our challenge that we are investigating. And I show the state of art about the fusion of the inner mitochondrial membrane.
Foundation for me is a really big honor to be here. Because speaking in the symposium, because most likely I don't think I would be here speaking at all if I had not been to a Nichols lab, because he was my PhD advisor. And if there's one thing that he taught me, extending on what Alicia mentioned, is really to follow your path, to choose your path and to follow your path. And that's what I did, and that's why I ended up working on DNA repair, which apparently has nothing to do with mitochondria, but it has a lot to do, and I hope to convince you that DNA repair is important for mitochondrial function, although I'm not exactly speaking about that. I'm going to speak today about Alzheimer's disease.
So my name is Anita Kowalkowski and I'm from the biochemistry department in the University of São Paulo. And I'm going to talk today about one specific work in my lab that comes from a more general interest that my lab has, studying the relationship between dietary interventions, mitochondrial energy metabolisms, and age-related diseases. And we studied this in many different models, including in rodent models.
So I really like to thank for this opportunity to Dr. Norbert that took a 22-hour flight to be here today, and I really appreciate your effort to be here and to share with us your results. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's, can you hear me? Yeah, this is good. Okay, so yeah, first, thank you for the invitation, Mario. It's great to be to have the opportunity to visit Brazil for the first time with me there. And so what I want to do here today is to tell you about some of the work we're doing on cell signaling in flies and those of that. And what I'm going to show you is I'm going to discuss some of the technologies that we've been using over the past 15 or 20 years or so to really identify components of signaling networks and try to understand the relationships. And I'm going to show you to illustrate some of the applications that we have made over the years and some of the ongoing work that we are doing in this area.
The function of the inhibitor And its compact size and resistance to proteolysis, we did up to 24-hour incubations of this with proteases. It does not get cleaved. Actually, we measure the presence of the full-length inhibitor in the crystal that had been incubated for weeks at 20 degrees, and they are intact. There are no identifiable segments, fragments. So maybe we can use this to, as leads to design new inhibitors, which we can potentially use in some clinical settings. Restricted settings, but still, there are some.
So I'll try to talk about, when I submitted my talk, I wanted to talk about some of the information that we are getting from our proteome data. We have sequenced, identified a lot of proteins that are systematically secreted by ticks during feeding. That protein that the ticks actually sequentially inject into the host every 24 hours. And when looking into this data, we are seeing that there is a potential that they take as an equivalent mechanism for antigenic variation.
So in the afternoon, Professor, I would like to thank to SBBQ and Dr. Gustavanak for the invitation. And today I'm going to talk about the ghetto tick saliva as a source of certain proteinase inhibitors, specifically the proteins belonging to the certain superfamily. So the ghetto tick Ipsilophus micropus is a blood-sucking ectoparasite that causes a very loss in livestock industry. In Brazil, it's about $2 billion per year. And this tick is vector of several diseases like babesia and anaplasma, and the control is based on use of chemical parasites. So the study of physiology, the tick physiology, could lead to the identification of new targets for vaccine-based control.
We purified from the tick Ornithogalus mumbata, and they both genes and the trombin inhibitor from both those microbes or Cephalus microbes.
So we decided to take an unbiased approach and use a modeling approach to try and identify the target for nicotinamide acetate system. And what we did is we performed transcriptome analysis of all the genes regulated by acetate plus or minus nicotinamide. So this column is minus nicotinamide, this is plus nicotinamide. And then we used a tool called linear time invariant models for system identification to connect those transcripts. Essentially what you do is you treat each transcript as a node, and you make an input-output model. So it's time series data. Essentially if you have CCA1 and top one, sorry, you have to do this. You make a mathematical model between the two. Say, if CCA1 goes up, how does it regulate top one? And we did that for every gene in the system. You end up with a network that looks like this. But then we did it under two conditions. So, sorry, this network is red light input, white chromes, blue light input, crypto chromes, what components, vague components in yellow, night components in sort of dark blue. Okay?
Our hypothesis for the suboptimal conditions, stress condition, is that if you have stress condition, it's not composed. It leads to increase in the oxygen, the physical activity using oxygen as a substrate, and increase flux through for respiration. It will, of course, reduce the triosphosphate production by the photosynthesis, leading to reduction in the ATP production by the one. So the level of ATP that is producing under this condition is used for the cell metabolism, not for the growth requirements as the optimal condition. And then we think that there is an increase in this exchange of redox voice on the chloroplast with mitochondria. Photorespiratory reactions that we gain in age, and also increase the production of this ordinary acids to regulate the somatic mutation. This is what we think happens under physiological conditions. Of course, we need to grow more months under stress conditions and check the character.
So when we think about DNA, it's hard not to just think of a Watson-Crick double helix. But as I like to tell the students in my genetics classes, there's actually more protein in a chromosome than there is DNA in a chromosome. So about two-thirds of a chromosome is protein, about half of that is histones. And histones are an octamer, so there's 8 subunits with 2 copies of each of these subunits. So histone 2A, 2B, histone 3, and histone 4. And this makes up sort of the basic functional unit of chromatin, which is this nucleosome. So with each histone subunit, you get about 2.5 wraps of DNA around each one of those histones. And then one of the keys to the organization of chromatin inside the nucleus is modifications that go on those histone proteins. And some of these modifications cause the nucleosomes to spread apart and make DNA more accessible to things like transcription factors, whereas other modifications just do the opposite and make DNA compress more tightly together and helping to exclude things like RNA polymerases, and this leads to a silent state.
Respiratory factors, which bind to many genes that involve the mitochondrial function. And this is true of genes that direct the respiratory chain, but also genes that are involved in the transcription and replication of mitochondrial DNA and in the production of cofactors, for example, heme, which is required by a number of mitochondrial cytokines. And this view has been expanded in the late 90s. Through the work of Kushner and Bruce Spiegelman's lab at Harvard, with the discovery of PTC1 alpha. And PTC1 alpha is a coactivator. And the important thing about PTC1 alpha is that it's a regulated coactivator. So when we look at this system, we can see that many physiological inputs can affect either the expression or the activity of PTC1 alpha. And so we have cold and fasting, for example, can work through cyclic AMP to increase the expression of PTC1 alpha. And other things, for example, post translational modifications in response to exercise or energy deprivation, can modify the molecule either through deacetylation by SIRT1 or phosphorylation by AMPK to change its activity. And of course, PTC1 supposedly works by binding these transcription that are involved in mitochondrial metabolism and other forms of metabolism, and they can recruit histone acetylides containing coactivators via a very potent amino terminal activation domain that resides at the end of the growth molecule. So this is the basic paradigm for communication of physiological signals from the environment to the nuclear transcription and apparatus that controls mitochondrial biogenesis.
What about the relationship between melatonin and diabetes? We have a decrease of melatonin secretion in all animal models of diabetes. For example, here in GK rats, we have a normal mice with a normal melatonin secretion, and there is a decrease in diabetic animals. The same results we can see here in diabetic type 2 diabetic patients. Then there is a disturbance of melatonin secretion in diabetes.
Published, but to make a point here, we found that this phenomenon was more obvious in adipose tissue. We actually didn't see much in other tissues, but there are other recent papers that also show the effect of aging in other tissues, including humans. So we found that this is conserved in humans, so aging in pre-adipocytes of humans decreased the isogram microglia expression, as well as in the nematode C. elegans. And this is obviously conserved, and recently Jan Kornfeld group showed that Dicer is also downregulated in fat by obesity, and Michelle Evans' lab showed that it's upregulated by metformin in several human samples. And we know that exercise, this is a published data from my lab, showing that exercise also upregulates Dicer. This is causally linked to aging and stress resistance in C. elegans, since downregulation of Dicer decreases lifespan and upregulation of Dicer increases lifespan. And we came up with a model where stress or aging decreases Dicer, microRNAs, some of these microRNAs affect cell function, cell senescence, that in turn leads to an increase in the risk to age-related diseases. And that the restriction, we now know exercise and potentially metformin, which is the widely type 2 diabetes drug, can prevent this effect.
Process, it seems to be an important mechanism to protect the animals, to protect the muscle cell against the mitochondrial-related diseases, including insulin resistance, right?
Esse vídeo é muito bom.
Deixou uma reduzida em vírus capaz de comprar o vídeo de
Lifetime. Thank you for the invitation for the talk today here. I'm glad to have you guys here, and my talk will touch a little bit about the outbreak in Brazil of Zika. And at the end of the talk, we're going to show some of our results in our lab, and also the remaining open question about the epidemic. That are many so far, unfortunately. Zika virus was isolated in 1947, where people were studying yellow fever. They put some, rhesus monkeys to be like a bite for mosquitoes and isolate the virus. And when they saw the virus isolated was not yellow fever, was another virus that they called Zika because of the name of the forest.
On the lethal dose, so we measure for insects.
Yes.
Yeah, we measure in picomoles per gram rather than mass, so we can compare peptides with different masses. So. It varies from, as I said, the mosquitoes and tritomines are really sensitive, so 25 picomoles per gram, really low, up to the hardest things to kill, as always, Helica burpera, midra, the cotton bollworm, really tough to kill, so probably 1,000 for Helica burpera.
How do you ramidase like enzymes in spider venoms are better endocrine acidases, which occur here in the very primitive spiders, the megalomorph spiders, as well as in the more modern spiders, the araneomorph spiders, and also here in these red boxes in the evolutionary youngest spiders of the RTA.
Thank you very much, Mary, for accepting. She's here on vacation, and then when I saw that her vacation was overlapping our meeting, so of course she was invited to. Thank you, Mary, for your vacation.
Okay, thank you, Selma, and I'm very grateful to be able to give this talk here. I just want to say that that Selma's been a wonderful collaborator for many years, and if you don't know her well, you should get to know her, because she's also a wonderful person and a great cook, too. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk about the microbiome. I'll start with a summary of some of what's known about the human microbiome and its effect on health. And then I'm going to go shortly over a study we've been doing looking at actually not the human microbiome, but the microbiome in the insect vector that transmits leishmaniasis.
Participação dos jovens, que também mais uma vez, os convidados estrangeiros também ficam sempre impressionados, tanto com a participação deles como dos jovens, e também pela distribuição que geralmente não ocorre em outros países, da questão do gênero. Né? Então, aqui é está ganhando. Então, agora a gente vai chegar para um dos momentos mais importante da nossa reunião, assim, no sentido de, principalmente na finalização, que é a premiação do Prêmio Jovem Talento, que agora está na sua 20ª edição. Então, vou chamar o professor José Roberto para dar a palavra, professor José Roberto, vice-presidente da SPB.
Boa noite a todos. Esse ano, um disperso da vice-presidência da sociedade, que é uma das incumbências do vice-presidente organizar, articular a premiação do Jovem Talento. Nesse caso, mais uma vez, queria agradecer imensamente a Cíntia, ao Arnaldo, ao Marcelo, que as pessoas às vezes não têm noção do trabalho que eles fazem, porque é todo ano. A Secretaria funciona o ano inteiro, não é só aqui durante os encontros. Então, muito obrigado por tudo. Eu não sei se todos sabem, esse é o 20º prêmio. Porque há 20 anos atrás, o professor Paulo Antônio Souza Mourão, quando era então vice-presidente da sociedade, na gestão presidida pela professora Helena Scoffo, naquele ano, a presidência e a vice-presidência estavam no Rio de Janeiro, o professor Paulo Mourão idealizou, foi ele que idealizou o Prêmio Jovem Talento. Então, junto com a GR, há 20 anos a gente vem premiando aqueles que mais se destacam, os jovens que mais se destacam, tanto no Brasil como nos países espanhóis da América do Sul. Os cinco estudantes, ex-estudantes, jovens, selecionados para estar aqui apresentando seus trabalhos, foram o Ernesto Martim Cueva Santa Dans, do Instituto de Química Biológica da Universidade de La República do Uruguai, Jorge Esteban Dias Fuentes, da Universidade de Chile, Maíra Assunção Bica, da Universidade Federal de Santa Catarina, Michel Vinícius da Costa Lourenço, do Instituto de Bioquímica Médica Leopoldo Emês, da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro, e Fernanda Maria Policarpo Tonelli, da Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais.
E aproveitando até as palavras do professor Paulo Mourão, ele não pôde estar aqui hoje, mas eu conversei um pouquinho com ele se ele gostaria de passar uma mensagem no dia de hoje, depois de 20 anos. E ele me disse o seguinte, ele falou, talvez hoje esse prêmio seja mais importante do que 20 anos atrás, isso foi uma das coisas que ele me disse. E a segunda foi que o jovem cientista, ele precisa de oportunidade, ele precisa de competência, ele precisa de muita pesquisa e ele precisa de destaque. É com grande prazer que eu anuncio que o vencedor do 20º Prêmio Jovem Talento de Ciências da Vida de 2016 é a Maíra Assunção Pica.
Então, ainda na questão dos prêmios, vou passar então agora para o Eduardo, vai passar para premiar provavelmente futuros candidatos ao Prêmio Jovem Talento.
Então, agora a gente vai passar para a sessão de prêmios.
Esse ano tiveram 546 trabalhos, né, que foram apresentados aqui na reunião, que concorreram ao prêmio. Né, e para avaliar esses trabalhos, tanto no aspecto da qualidade, quanto também para a apresentação dos cartazes em si, foi convocada uma comissão com 36 membros, né, aqui da sociedade, com especialistas nas diversas áreas que foram tratadas nesses trabalhos. Né. Antes de, né, começar a anunciar os premiados, queria destacar que vários desses que avaliadores comentaram sobre a dificuldade de fazer uma indicação, tendo em vista que tinham vários trabalhos com muita qualidade, eles gostariam de ter tido a chance de fazer mais do que uma indicação. Tá? Então, acho que isso mostra que a gente tem uma sociedade pujante, né, cientificamente, e que, né, as pessoas se sentem motivadas a cada vez trazer trabalhos melhores para cá. Bom, então, o que é o prêmio? Na verdade, o prêmio vai ser um certificado, uma plaquinha que a gente vai chamar aqui os apresentadores para virem receber, ou então, se não tiverem presente, alguém que faça parte também do trabalho, e eles vão receber também pelo correio um livro, O Que é o Metabolismo, que é um livro recente, publicado pela nossa colega Alicia Kowalkowski, que vai ser também oferecido aos premiados. Então, chamo aqui a Juliana Camacho Pereira, da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro. Ariane Marinotto, da Unesp de Botucatu. O Giovanni Henrique Almeida Perini, da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro. A Isabela Daniel Sardinha Caldeira, da Universidade de São Paulo. A Sheila Lopes, da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro. Thaísa Cristina Roat, da Universidade Estadual Paulista Júlio de Mesquita Filho. Paulo Roberto Ribeiro, da Universidade Federal da Bahia. A Márcia Daniela de Araújo Dantas, da Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Norte. E Alexandre Vivesca de Maldonado, da Universidade Estadual de São Paulo. Né? Letícia Miguel, da Universidade Estadual Paulista, Júlio de Mesquita Filho. Tene Rui Caetano, do Instituto de Química da Universidade de São Paulo. Leonardo Barcelos de Paula, da Universidade de São Paulo, de Ribeirão Preto. Manuela da Silva Cardoso, da Universidade Federal Fluminense. Francisco de Assis Leone, da Faculdade de Filosofia, Ciências e Letras de Ribeirão Preto, da Universidade de São Paulo. Rubens Daniel Miserani Magalhães, do Hospital Sírio-Libanês. Yoni Romã, da Universidade Federal do Paraná. Paulinho Pai Siqueira, da Universidade Federal de Viçosa. Felipe Mendes de Araújo, da Universidade Federal da Bahia. Camila de Souza Gomes, da Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais. Mariana Lopes Graça, da Universidade de São Paulo. E, por último, Vinícius Storm, da Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Sul.
Anunciar também que a nossa 46ª reunião anual, 2017, será entre 12 e 15 de junho, volta agora para o Sudeste, em Águas de Lindóia. Aproveitem a última noite de Natal nessa bela cidade. Obrigado a todos.
Eu Então, galera, essa foi a reunião da Sociedade Brasileira de Bioquímica e Biologia Molecular desse ano. Ano que vem a gente vai ter Águas de Lindóia. O vídeo ficou muito grande, tem postado tudo pra vocês. Se você gostou, clica no joinha aqui embaixo para mais pessoas poderem ver. Se inscreve no canal para receber as atualizações por e-mail. Compartilhe nas redes sociais para os amigos poderem ver. E depois a gente volta com mais vídeos. Um abraço.